Hello and welcome to this episode on the enforcement and investigation provisions of the New Companies Act 2013. In this episode, we will discuss provisions relating to punishments, penalties, investigations, inspections, and the new provision on the statutorily empowered Serious Fraud Investigation Office. To discuss these subjects with us, we have with us Mr. Sharad Abhyankar, who is a partner with Khetan & Company, a large national law firm, and Lalit Kumar, a partner with J. Sagar Associates, a large national law firm. So let me start by asking you, Lalit, if you could give us an overview of the provisions relating to punishment in Chapter 29.
Thank you, Som. For the first time in Companies Act 2013, they have introduced a specific section 447, which deals about what will be the meaning of fraud and the punishments related to that. The punishments are stringent, and then they range from 6 months to 10 years of imprisonment and fine, which could lead from the amount which is involved in fraud and can go up to three times of the amount involved in fraud. One important point here is they have made distinction in cases when public interest is involved, for which the minimum imprisonment prescribed is 3 years and not 6 months. So these are the new provision.
Can you elaborate a bit on how public interest would be involved in a fraud and examples of where public interest may not be involved?
All right. Public interest means or is considered to be a situation or a circumstance where a reasonable man would perceive or would see that his interest has been prejudiced, and the court also look into those aspects that whether the public at large was prejudiced or not. Let me give you an example. Say in case of a privately held company, it has accessed bank finance and bank facilities on the basis of false accounts, and the books were cooked, and it has given on the basis of that, it has got the bank finance. Now these banks have public deposits with them. So what it could mean that it was public money or public deposited money with the bank, which eventually on the basis of the falsified accounts went to the company. This could be a case of public interest being involved and being prejudiced, but importantly, it is based on the facts and circumstances of each case.
Right. So it'll be a mixed question of fact and law.
That's right.
In each case.
That's right. Let me take an example where in a similar situation, when there's a closely held private company, but it would not be public interest involved. Say there are two joint venture partners, and then there is a fraud in the company between these two JV partners. In such a situation, there's no public interest involved, there's no public involved in the company. So this will fall in the category of a fraud which is not in the public interest.
Unless, of course, one of the JV partners is itself a public listed company. So in which case, in each case, you'll have to determine whether public interest is involved. And if it's involved, the minimum imprisonment goes up to 3 years.
3 years. And okay. While in the other cases, as I said, right, is 6 months.
What are the other provisions of penalty that you would like to highlight?
Yes, there are two other sections that have been introduced. This section 448, which deals with situations where the statements or certificates or even prospectus has statements which are false. In that situation, if the statements which are given there, the facts which are given there are incorrect, are false, or it omits certain material facts, and persons responsible for those statements know that it was the facts were wrong or the material information was missing, was omitted, they will be liable for same penalty as is for fraud, which is in section 447, which we just discussed. And again, the distinction will be made whether it involves public interest. Like in case of prospectus having a wrong statement or misses a material fact, it will be a public interest because it will be public shareholder who will invest in the company. So this is one provision with respect to the falsification of the statements. The other is then when a false evidence is given. In that situation, there is a penalty, but it's different from fraud. It ranges from imprisonment from 3 years to 10 years, as against 6 months to 10 years.
So if you lie to an investigator, you would have given false evidence, and therefore you're liable to a minimum imprisonment of
3 years. That's right.
So they raise the bar for the quality of the evidence being given. I mean, you can't lie and get away lightly.
That's right. Right. And these are new provisions which have come, and specifically in the chapter of fraud,
right,
which falls under the miscellaneous chapter, chapter 29.
Right. Sir, can
also
I come?
On the issue relating to prospectus, it is not just the issuer or the principal officer in default. Now it interestingly involves even the merchant bankers and R&D agents who are treated with the same obligation on misstatement in prospectus, and even they can be liable for the same penalty under 447, so which is quite an advancement on penal law.
Right. Can we also talk a bit about the concept of penalty which leads to imprisonment or fine on the one hand, and the section which relates to civil penalty in the form of
fines,
adjudication by an adjudicating officer? So if you could touch upon that aspect of the
sure.
Act.
So when it is computation of fine, which is a monetary penalty that is likely to be imposed, clearly the adjudication process will take into account what is the nature of offense, what is the unlawful gain that has been obtained, is there any unlawful loss caused to a third party, or is it even of a repetitive nature. These attributes will be taken into account while computing a monetary penalty. Whereas when we are looking at more severe consequences like imprisonment, clearly the burden of proof is much higher. On one hand, in case of civil liability, the burden of proof will be to the of a
the
level
of
standard of proof will be preponderance of probabilities.
Right.
Whereas if it is going to lead to an imprisonment, clearly it has to be beyond all reasonable doubt.
As in a criminal trial.
As in a criminal
right.
trial.
Right. Can we then move on to analyzing a little bit about whether the Act differentiates between violations which could be visited with a civil penalty and the provisions which would lead to a criminal prosecution and an imprisonment or fine. Can we talk a bit about the difference in approach in these provisions?
In fact, yes, there is a distinction made. There are certain sections on which there is a specific provision for penalty. There are certain sections where there is a very specific provision of fine. And even the Institute of Company Secretary's website, the background note that they've prepared, it lists out what will be those provisions for which the penalty will be attracted and for which provisions there will be fine, a monetary fine, as you said. So there's a detailed provisions there in the Companies Act. So one could look at the background note of the Institute of Company Secretaries to get the specific of those sections where such distinction has been made.
Can we talk a little bit for the benefit of viewers on who can initiate the criminal prosecution? What is the process by which the criminal justice system can be set into motion under the Companies Act?
Yes, chapter 14 is a very detailed chapter now. Certain new provisions have also been introduced in it. The starting point, as is under the Companies Act also, is the registrar of companies, who has access to all the information and documents of the company. He can, if he sees that there is something which is not right in the documents and information furnished, he suspects that he needs to inquire. The first point is that he could send notices to the company, he could ask information from the company to see whether the provisions of the Act have been complied with. Then even the power has been given to central government, and central government can, in the public interest, central government could also, in cases where the board of, I beg your pardon, the shareholders of the company pass a special resolution and feel that there could be some kind of investigation and inquiry needed in that company, cases where some departments of the government or some you know, bodies of the government feel that there is a good case to investigate it, that could be made to the government. An application could be made to the government, and government can decide on its own and can initiate the investigation and inquiry, which is where this concept of the Serious Fraud Investigation Office comes.
Right. We'll come to SFIO specifically a little later in the episode. But overview, can
so
you
there give? Is another mechanism under which inspection and investigation can actually trigger, and which is on the basis of the members of the company complaining. And there are certain thresholds, like 1/10 of the number of members or 1/5 of the number of members, depending on the type of company. If they make a complaint to the central government, clearly the central government will be required to initiate an investigation.
And then what happens next? Once the
investigation process begins, very interestingly, now Companies Act very specifically says that all the investigating officers have full powers of search and seizure under the Criminal Procedure Code. Mm-hmm. So these are very, very significant provisions that they get, particularly visiting officers, searching documents, taking custody of documents, even seizing certain documents or even hard disk of computers. These can all be taken custody of. While there are, of course, CRPC deals with a very detailed procedures.
So this will need a warrant from a magistrate or a
This will need, in case of special searches where you want to seize, surely there will be a warrant.
Right.
There can also be searches without warrant. Clearly, there may be situations where there is information warranting a possible problem with the company, and the authorities believe that the information may not is just not forthcoming, but there is a possibility of destruction of evidence.
Okay.
In such cases, searches can be taken even without a formal warrant.
Okay.
And the Companies Act also deals with a duty of all the officers, all the employees, and more interestingly, it is even the past employees and officers and directors who have been obliged to make do a full cooperation with the investigations. So it is not the current employees set of employees, but it is also the past directors and employees who
right.
can be called upon. And if you see,
and if you falsify a reply there, you're liable.
You are liable
under 3 years imprisonment.
Yes, that's right. So the powers of the investigation also include today the same powers of a civil court for summoning witnesses, asking them to make statements on oath, recording, and ultimately even making them aware that some of these statements could actually be used against them,
mm-hmm.
but make them obviously sign those statements so that the investigation process can be completed.
Right.
Just to add what Sharad said, that even the accused has to be produced before the judicial magistrate within 24 hours, and there's a specific provision for that, and the time which is required to cover the journey, that time has to be excluded. So that is also one provision.
Right. The yeah. usual, of course, the in terms of timing, it has to be done usually during the daytime,
right.
and the searches cannot be really unless the situation warrants. They are not supposed to be undertaken during the night. Obviously, if there are documents or any movables to be taken custody of, there has to be a complete inventory done in presence of witnesses.
Right.
There will be clearly a control on who can come in and who can really exit from that entire scene. Usually,
okay.
it's the premises really gets
so
seen.
Detailed provisions for how a search and seizure process should be undertaken are now
they are part of the Criminal Procedure Code, and they have now been referred by
Correct.
The Companies Act empowers with the same powers of search and seizure as under the Criminal Procedure Code. They have been given the same absolutely the same powers.
Got it. The other question I wanted to ask is you do a search and seizure, you do an investigation, what does that lead to next? It leads to an inspection report.
That's right.
And so, could you talk us through what happens with the report? What are the powers available to deal with the findings in an investigation?
The inspector or the registrar of companies is required to prepare the report. There are provisions of both final reporting to the central government and also interim reporting, and if the investigation goes for a longer time. Now, the findings of the report will lead to what was the offence for which what are the prosecutions. And interestingly, when the report of the inspector is taken to be a report similar to that of a police officer under Section 173 of the CRPC. So the inspector would submit the report and would and the provisions which are applicable, I mean the offences which have taken place, the penalties and the fine with respect to that will be imposed on the defaulting company, on the defaulting officers, and so there are specific provisions. So it will depend upon what the fine is and what the penalty for that provision is. But there are specific provisions for submitting report and a detailed report, and there are provisions where the company and the officer will be given reasonable opportunity of being heard. There are provisions where the findings have to be recorded in writing. So there are sufficient provision to prepare the report and submit it to the government or to the Serious Fraud Investigation Office, whichever is undertaking that investigation.
Can we talk a bit about? We hear a lot about the disgorgement powers that are now in the Act. How does all this now move into that sphere? What are the provisions which deal with disgorgement of ill-gotten gains out of a violation of the Companies Act?
So there's one very specific provision, which is Section 224 and subsection 5, which provides that, say, the inspector submits the report, and in his finding, he believes that the fraud is committed by any director of the company, any key managerial personnel, any other officer of the company. As a result of that fraud, that officer or director or the KMP has got undue advantage on company's assets, company's property, company's cash. Central government, on getting this report, as a finding of the inspector in this report, will have to make an application to the National Company Law Tribunal. Explain the case that this is a case of disgorgement. And the tribunal can then order of the disgorgement of the assets or the cash or the property which is unduly gained by that officer or director or KMP. And interestingly, it can also impose personal unlimited liability on these officers. So this is also a new provision which is not there presently in the Companies Act, and I think it will go a long way in making sure that the people who are officers and the KMPs and other officers in default on the company do not take any undue advantage of their position.
Right. Sharad, do you want to come in on that and talk a bit about the implications of such a disgorgement provision and the interplay it may even have with the securities regulator who also uses powers under sections 11, 11B to disgorge ill-gotten gains?
So these powers under the Companies Act can actually be more useful for unlisted companies. SEBI will obviously come in when a company is listed or when a company has an intention to list its securities. SEBI will be more relevant authority to take such action. Again, it will entirely depend on who initiates the investigation and whether the report is filed with the central government or SEBI within its powers starts or commences the process to investigate. It will depend on which authority, and clearly under Companies Act today we have both the authorities governing, both have been given powers to administer Companies Act itself.
Right.
More in relation to securities, obviously the SEBI has powers under the Act, and for non-listed companies or when the company does not wish to list its securities, the central government or the registrar of companies will have these powers.
Right.
But there is somewhat an overlap, and there clearly they have equivalent powers in terms of what they can actually do to an offending person.
Which brings me to actually in my mind a thought about multiplicity of proceedings, but I think I'm jumping the gun. Before that, could I veer this discussion around to the SFIO and what the SFIO can do, what the Act does for the SFIO? So if you can give us an overview of the provision in the Act which deals with the Serious Fraud Investigation Office, when it can be set in motion, what are the contours of its powers, and what is it that it can do? That would be useful to know, because I do understand there are provisions which deal with multiplicity once the SFIO comes into play. So if you could maybe...
Sure. So Section 211 is empowered to create a SFIO. There is currently a mechanism which is more of a nebulous structure of multidisciplinary investigating agencies. This was constituted under a 2003 notification by the central government. Now it will get a statutory status. So under Section 211, central government by notification will formally constitute a SFIO, which is nothing but experts from multiple disciplines. So mm-hmm. there are experts from banking, there are experts from accountancy, there are experts from investigation. The manner of investigating financial frauds or white collar crimes. So there will be experts, all these experts will be pooled together essentially to go beyond a mere compliance by companies and really to go behind the accounts or the manner of presentation of accounts to find out whether there is a whitewash that has been done into the account making process, or there has been a really an intent to defraud the investors in some way, and are there any mechanisms whereby these different angles to merely reading and are there issues relating to siphoning, where is it possible to track these funds which have gone out of the company, is there a money trail that can be traced and which can pinpoint to a particular offender. So the biggest advantage is that when this SFIO comes in, all serious financial frauds can be referred, and there are multiple ways in which it can be referred to SFIO.
Right. I think we briefly touched upon the four means of setting the SFIO in motion, which are essentially a suo moto power of the government, reference by any state agency, a special resolution passed by
the shareholders. And the other is in public interest, which is again...
Right, which is a suo moto power of the government in any case.
That's right.
But having said that, what does this do for multiplicity of proceedings? What if the securities regulator is chasing the very same fraud, or some other agency is chasing the same fraud, and the SFIO has been set in motion? Does the Act have a specific provision?
There is a special provision under Section 212. That whenever SFIO process is set in motion, all other investigation agencies and all pending proceedings will really cede to the SFIO investigation. So one of the most positive elements of the Companies Act provisions is that multiplicity of investigative agencies, procedures and prosecutions can be completely eliminated. Now you have almost like a single window to investigate and initiate proceedings based on whatever are the, and the advantage is that it is not merely looking at a compliance or accounting standard or a strict one act provision. It is looking at a multiple possibilities and ultimately trying to identify who are the culprits behind this the scene and at times where it is even very difficult to track down the offenders. The SFIO, I think, as a single mechanism will achieve much more than, amateurs who keep on trying with different things and still cannot reach to the final conclusion.
So, the prosecuting agency in this case would be the SFIO.
Yes.
That would be the agency that would move the criminal justice system into action. That would be the agency which would file the charge sheet before the criminal court, and meanwhile, other regulatory agencies will suspend and instead cooperate
with the SFIO and will actually hand over the...
So, it will be a one-stop shop for
Yes.
A serious fraud investigation.
Yes. In fact, to add what Sharad said, that even there is a specific provision which says that Income Tax Department, all other government departments have to, if SFIO asks for information, not only they have to stop the proceedings, that is with them, they have to also share all material information, all material findings that they had about that company which is getting investigated to SFIO.
Right.
Similarly, SFIO at the end of the proceedings has gathered all facts and information and documents. If these agencies ask, Income Tax Office and SEBI, so they will have to even provide it to that authority. So it is like there's one body which is going to investigate frauds,
right?
And as a result of which the findings can then be shared with other regulators as well, other agencies. So this is also a very welcome step and gives more power and teeth to SFIO.
Right.
One of the novel feature, if I may call it, of the report of SFIO is not a secret confidential document. Any person who is concerned or aggrieved with such a report can actually seek formally. There is a special provision in the Act which says please apply and you will get. So the if there is any doubt, if there is any fear in the minds of the boards or the managers that there could be a witch hunt, I think this provision to say that yes, a copy of the entire investigation report
is
filed by SFIO
available.
Is transparently available. If you feel aggrieved, please apply for it. You will get a complete copy.
Right. Equally, the flip side could be then that a public shareholder in a listed company could seek access as a person interested in the proceedings and therefore initiate his own civil proceedings.
Somewhat unlikely, because okay. the report will be available only to the person aggrieved.
Okay.
So that would be really a test to say that are you a person aggrieved, and if so, then of course you have to be given a full access.
So these are again mixed questions of fact and law with
yes.
As and when the courts interpret the jurisprudence.
True. But I think there is a fair amount of check and balance that while there are provisions which have on the penal side have been made very stringent, I think there is a good amount of protection that these powers are not misused and abused.
Right. So we will also be having a separate episode on the division of powers and the scope of how what SEBI does, what the company law authorities would do. So of course our readers would be urged to view that episode as well. But is there any other aspect of investigations and enforcements that you would like to touch upon as being highlights of this new law?
So I'll touch upon two issues which I don't think are there in the Companies Act, and that also is
in the old Companies
Act. This is with respect to freezing the assets, and there's a specific section, and also restricting the transfer of securities. There are two different aspects. So let's talk about the freezing of assets. In cases where during the process of investigation, if it is felt that there is a specific section 244 which is in operation and mismanagement, and there are certain number of applicants or members who can apply to get the case investigated from the perspective of operation mismanagement. If those number of members, applicant, or interestingly even a creditor whose 1 lakh of rupees is outstanding and due can make a report, make a request saying that, you know, the assets, there is a fear that the assets will be removed, will be transferred, will be disposed of, and an order should be passed to freeze those assets. This power has been given, and assets can be freezed up to a maximum of 3 years, subject to such terms and conditions which the order will pass. That's one aspect.
Second, assets of a company.
Assets of the company can be frozen. Another aspect is that when the investigation is with regard to who's the true owner of the company, who is behind the control of the company, in order to determine the true owner of the company, it is needed and required that the security should not be transferred, so that if, you know, the defaulting promoters can go out or defaulting majority shareholders can go out. So specific power has been given up to a maximum of 3 years, an order can be passed to even stop any transfer of any securities.
So would it be fair to say that serious remedial protective powers have been granted in the Act in the course of investigation?
That's right.
Because the test would be to demonstrate that there is a risk of loss to the assets, or the assets may be disturbed, or evidence may be destroyed.
That's right. And that's right. And this is a very, very new change which gives more powers.
Right. Okay. So I think before we conclude, can I invite each of you to give an overview of your thoughts and summarize these provisions of what are the key takeaways in chapter 29 or in chapter 14 in the area of investigations, inspection and penalties. If you could just synopsize in a couple of minutes each.
Sure. So in relation to the definition of fraud itself, one element is of course falsifying a document or giving wrong evidence, which would be a deliberate action. I think the concept of fraud begins with an intent to cheat, and
right.
that has been the basic ingredient of the definition, that unless the investigating authorities also are able to really pinpoint that where did it all begin? It began
right.
somewhere with an intent to create a fraud, intent to defraud.
Right. And any fraud requires an intent.
That's a very basic element.
Right.
So that in a way, it is not merely an act per se or any loss to an investor which can be perceived as a fraud. But when the investigation goes on and when the report concludes, it will have to really demonstrate the state of mind and how it originated from a certain intention.
Right.
So that in a way is protecting unwary actions,
right.
Or sometimes an adventurous business call
right.
That the companies may take,
which is very important. Otherwise, you stifle and stymie interesting decision making.
Yes.
And attack it as fraud. Right.
So the boards are, of course, indeed entitled to commit commercial blunders. That is not negligence. Till the time they have all the information, they are well informed and taking a commercial call on a certain transaction. So merely a company making a loss or company losing money on a certain transaction cannot be perceived as a fraud,
right.
Or an intentional act.
Sure. Then do you want to?
Yes, I think just to add what Sharad said is the concept of fraud is new and it was much needed, and they have provided in the Companies Act. Penalties are very stringent, so it will be seen that how it is actually implemented. With respect to investigation and inquiry, the most important change in my view is setting up of the Serious Fraud Investigation Office and giving it power and teeth. Let me just quickly add, I think the two new provisions which are there, in fact, during the investigation, the employees are protected, because if the investigator wants to check certain things about the company from the employees, the company cannot dismiss, company cannot retrench and terminate the services of that employee, cannot they change their terms or make it disadvantage for them to continue with the company unless they get an approval from NCLT. So this protection of the employee during investigation is also a new provision. And for lawyers, they have specifically provided that information which is their client
privileged
information cannot be disclosed, because this was not
that's
there.
A constitutional
right. So in my view, yes, it's all the changes are towards giving more power to the authorities to protect the interests of the shareholders, minority shareholder and public shareholder at large.
Thank you. That's it from us on this episode on enforcement, investigations and inspection. I think it would be fair to say that our panelists have given us a very broad overview of the serious stringent powers, the seriousness with which fraud has been defined, and the manner in which a serious fraud investigation office has been created and fully empowered, suspending all parallel investigations to make it a focused area of activity in combating and detecting corporate fraud. And most importantly, as Sharad said, not to stymie decision making, commercial blunder versus outright fraud is the way he would put it. We'd encourage our viewers to actually read the provisions of the Act. In a discussion, you tend to give the highlights, but please do read the provisions. Chapter 29 and Chapter 14 are where you'll find them. That's it from us. Thank you very much. Thank you.